Hello, everybody, wherever you may be, from coast to coast and sea to shining sea. Welcome back to Ham Radio Live, where the world talks radio.
You must remember this. A kiss is still a kiss. A sigh is just a sigh. The fundamental things apply as time goes by.
We have Martin F. Jue, Mr. MFJ on today. Hope you enjoy
it. And when two lovers woo, they still say I love you. On that you can rely. No matter what the future brings, as time goes by.
Beautiful song from 1955, the great Parry.
Moonlight and love songs never out of date. Hearts full of passion, jealousy and hate. Woman needs man and man must have his mate. That no one can deny. It's still the same old story. Fight for love and glory. A case of do or die.
Again, the great Parry with a song.
The world will always welcome lovers as time goes by.
Absolutely perfect. Mr. Jue's request, Parry from the 50s. Music he grew up with. I'd like to start the show by saying away we go. Hello, everybody. Welcome back to the Shack in Oregon. My name's Larry. Welcome into the Shack. This is Ham Radio Live, where we talk radio every day. Try to, at least, about 1900 UTC. I want to apologize up front for my appearance. I had skin cancer surgery yesterday, and I have to keep these on for a little while. I appreciate that very much. I have a very rare guest today. And when I say rare, I say it because he doesn't do many interviews anymore. And we've been blessed to have him now. This is the third time. This is a very special interview with Martin F. Jue from MFJ. October is his 50th year at MFJ. Think about that, 50 years in business. I am so honored to have him join us today. I'd like to tell you all about the things we're doing and how to get into ham radio first, though. If you'd like to get your license, contact the American Radio Relay League, www.arrl.org. Please hit the contact us bar. Let them know where you live and you'd like your license. They'll send you an amateur radio club close to you. You contact that club and they'll help you get licensed. www.arrl.org. Tonight is CQ Calling, powered by ICOM, for the love of ham radio and shortwave radio, WRMI. Europe, North Africa, and the Middle East had it at 2015 UTC on 15770 kHz. Tonight to North America, 7:30 p.m. Eastern on 9395 kHz. And the Caribbean, Central and South America has a show tonight on 9955 kHz. And that show, by the way, on 9955 is simulcast on the internet stream at www.wrmi.net. If you'd like to email me, feel free and reach out at info@hamradiolive.org. All the way from Starkville, Mississippi, it is my true honor to introduce to you Mr. Martin F. Jue. Welcome, sir. It's good to have you. My gosh.
Well, thank you. I'm glad to be here with y'all.
This is such a treat. This is the man that started MFJ 50 years ago this month. This month, isn't that right?
That's right. It's been 50 years.
50 years. My goodness, the changes you have seen. I'd like to ask folks, if you'd like to ask Mr. Jue a question, and he's the only guy in amateur radio I use the word Mr. by, because he's so darn special, please put it in the comment section. Start it out with the word question, all right? And then we will make sure and ask Mr. Jue. 50 years, okay? Everyone has dreams that they're going to be very successful in life. But you grew up with a very special work ethic, didn't you?
Well, I did. I grew up in a little country grocery store in the rural part of the Mississippi Delta where cotton was king. And we were working in the store when we were 6 years old. We couldn't see over the countertop, so we had these milk crates we stood on to make change.
Wow, at 6 years old. And then you would consistently then work in the store? Is that what you were doing?
Oh, yeah. We stocking groceries, putting drinks in, sweeping the floors. That's what we all did.
It was the way to survive. Yeah, my grandfather taught me, if you don't work hard, you don't eat well. And I totally have learned that in life, and I truly, truly appreciate it. You guys were at three of the big ham fests this year. You went to Hamcation, of course you were Dayton, and then didn't you guys as well do Huntsville this year?
We did go to Huntsville.
Yep.
We did. Should my screen be blank?
Because you're not going to see me on the screen because we want to focus on you, my friend. We hear everything you're saying. And by the way, we're watching you too, so be careful, right?
All right.
And thank you, Jeff. One of our moderators, Jeff, November 4, Pop Oscar Delta. If you have a question, please put question at the beginning of your message. Jeff, thank you for posting that. And by the way, a very special viewer from the channel all the way from the continent of Africa. He lives in Namibia. And his name is Winan. His call sign, Victor51 Whiskey Whiskey. He says, greetings, Mr. Jew. And for people that don't know what he's doing right now, he's writing down the call sign. That's what he's doing. Victor51 Whiskey Whiskey. That's how much that stuff means to him. So Winan, thank you very much for that kind comment. What kind of challenges? Now, 50 years is a long time to be in business. What were some of the major hurdles you faced putting products in or just creating a product even? What's been some of the challenges you've faced over that 50 years?
Well, there's, starting a business in the beginning, you have no idea of what you're doing and just starting from scratch. But in the beginning, it was bringing in enough money to buy the parts, pay for the advertising, and then to hire people. Sourcing parts, there's just a lot of things. I mean, the major thing was just making a decision first just to come back home to Mississippi. I made a decision to come back to Mississippi to work on a PhD after working for a year as a circuit designer, designing military electronics for the Vietnam War. And then the second major decision was to leave the PhD program and teaching at Mississippi State to start a company to manufacture ham radio equipment. And, but it just step-by-step major decisions like that. I'm not sure where you want me to head.
No, you're fine. No, you're perfectly fine. Talk about the story about starting out in the hotel, the hotel room, because you started just building a filter for Super Heterodyne radios, didn't you?
That's right. It actually started in my apartment, but eventually, rented a hotel room in downtown Starkville. It was a rundown hotel right in town that it was a room that no one it couldn't be rented to anyone because there was no plumbing and it was just a rundown room. Mm-hmm. And but I was in that room by myself etching PC boards in a Pyrex disc over a hot plate to heat the etching solution and then drilling the board by hand and stuffing the parts and soldering it and getting it ready for mail. Did all of that. And the manager, after a couple of months, ran me off because I was making too much racket and stinking up the place.
We're live with Martin F. Jue, the founder of MFJ, and that was really the very beginning of MFJ, wasn't it?
At the very beginning, yeah.
Yeah. Tell, and then you also were at a point where you guys were spray painting cabinets black, and the cars in the parking lot started getting overspray of black on the cars too. What was that experience like?
Well, at the beginning, we were buying little cabinets from Radio Shack, and to put the hose in the cabinet, you could drill them, but what we did was to come up with a punch and die set by going to our local tool and die maker and had him make up a set where we could slide the box in between two plates that were separated about an eighth of an inch. And then it had hose in it, and the punch were pieces that we dropped into those hose in the die, and then we hit it with a hammer and punched the hole in it. Well, that worked out really well until we sold so many of those filters that we bought out all the cabinets that Radio Shack had in the entire country.
Oh, my gosh.
So I had to figure out how to get more cabinets. So I bought sheets of aluminum and had a local person who worked at MSU, and they had the equipment to cut those sheets of aluminum into the proper size and bend them so we could make cabinets out of them. Mm-hmm. But the problem was they were unpainted, so we had to paint them. And at the time, we had a 50-foot trailer, and we stood outside that trailer with water spraying in behind to catch the paint. And we spray painted them, and we wore these old World War II gas masks standing outside spray painting those cabinets. And it didn't take long for the cars that were parked around us to start looking like the color of those cabinets.
We're live with Mr. Martin F. Jue, Mr. MFJ. If you have a question, please post it in the comment section, just like Steve here, where he posts question as well as Jeff. That way I can make sure and get to your questions around the world. We're celebrating his 50th year, which is this month at MFJ. Jeff in Eastern Tennessee with a question for you. You have a vast collection of classic ham gear. What is your favorite item in that collection? Oh, we start. See, I told you it was going to start off with your collection. So if you want to show some of this stuff now, go ahead. It'd be a perfect time.
Okay, let's see. Now,
he's asking for your favorite.
My favorite, okay. Should I pick up the iPad and show it or just
sure.
Talk?
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. We'll figure out the iPad later. I think it'd be great to show it. Absolutely.
Okay.
Jeff, thanks for the question.
Can you see that? Let's see if I can. I don't know if you can see it. There's a collection on a top shelf. Let me just give you a quick scan.
Yeah, could get the top here a little higher. So a little higher on the iPad and a little more to your right. So higher and to your right.
Let me stand up.
I'm sorry to trouble you with this.
Oh, no problem. Can you see it or around
a little bit higher?
A little bit higher.
If they're a little higher, more still. Just hold it a little higher so it's pointing up. So points up more. There you go. There.
Okay.
There is just a portion of his collection.
Okay. Let me just kind of pan it around and maybe you can see a few more of these here.
Yep, that is Mr. Martin F. Jue's collection of amateur radio gear, transmitters, receivers, transceivers. And what Jeff's asking is, do you have a favorite amongst all of these?
Okay, let me see if I can get here. Can you see this?
Yes, sir. Yeah, sure.
That is a Night Kit Space Spanner regenerative receiver
not this particular one, but I still have my original one that I built when I must have been in the maybe seventh grade, eighth grade, something like that.
You are so gifted. So you were building things like that when you were 7 or 8 years old. Wow. Thanks for sharing that. So eighth there you grade, go, Jeff. Yeah. Well, that's a treat.
That was a regenerative receiver using two tubes and listened to the world on that. That was in seventh or eighth grade. Not when I was in 7 or 8 years old, I had built a crystal radio from a Cub Scout book that I never could get to work.
Oh, bless your heart. That's great. Is if there's a way we can move the top of the tablet towards the desk a little more, so more vertical. Go down with the top. I'm trying to get the top part to go down a little bit so we see more of you and less of all me. There you go. That's a little better. We'll take that. All right. If you have a question for Martin F. Jue, the founder of MFJ, his 50th year in business, please put him in the comment section. From the UK, Steve, welcome, my friend, to Echo Zero X-Ray Sierra Hotel, who, by the way, is studying now for his full license in the States. He says, Mr. Jue, in your 50 years, what change in technology do you think had the biggest impact on the ham radio hobby? Great question, Steve. Wow.
Okay, well, it's the, in recent times, it has been... SDRs, software-defined radios, but before then, it was to change from vacuum tubes to transistors.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, huge difference.
Yeah, huge difference, and then the change in the architect of radio. For so many years, radios was built on the principle of superheterodynes.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Now the principle is based on software-defined radio. That's probably has been the biggest change in the most recent years.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know, that's an interesting thing, because if you had tried to start to do in business now, okay, you started building filters for superheterodyne radios. If you were to start over again, say you're 50 years back again, and software-defined radios were already out, would there be a different thing you'd be looking to try and manufacture to work in radio?
Oh, it would be, as far as the radio was concerned, it would be pretty different for accessories that directly work with radio.
Yes, yes.
But the accessories that work with the ham radio stations would be a lot of the same. For example, you still need antenna switches. You still need antenna tuners.
Yep.
You still need amplifiers. So many of the products that were built in the past are still useful. And that's one of the things that we did as a principal, was to come up with classic products that no matter what change you would still need, for example, antenna switches.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah, that's a very good idea. I've got one of yours to my right here, and it works brilliantly. Six transceivers can be used. Six antennas can be used. It's just a great product. It's a MFJ 1700C. Love that product. Really do. That's a good one. A neat comment here from Jeff in Portland, Oregon. His call sign's Alpha Delta 7 Lima November. He said, Mr. Jue, thank you for all the radio accessories over the years. Almost all amateur operators own and use your various equipment. I own many MFJ tuners and SWR/power meters. Jeff, thank you so much. That's a nice comment. When you hear comments like that, I mean, you're a guy, when you go to MFJ, just to give folks a little imagery, you walk in, there's the office where these wonderfully kind ladies are answering the phone. You move just a little to your left, and then you're in the long hallway. And at the end of the hallway is a factory. That's where they're hand-building things. But along the walls, there are all these awards that MFJ has won over the years. Tons of them. Is there a favorite of those awards that you have, you know, you've received, that is very, very special to you?
Well, you know, I'm honored by all of those awards, and I value them all equally. I can't really choose one that I like better than others.
I like the one where, what was it, like the Asian Radio Association or something, they gave you a really nice plaque, beautiful award. And I can't remember what award was, but I know it came from Asia, basically, that they were, you know, so impressed with what you'd done. I think what you've done is a miraculous thing. So.
Well, thank you.
Yep. Don, November 5, Sierra Kilo Tango. Good question. How many famous hams have you met over the years or been able to work or work with, like Whiskey 6, Alpha Mike, or Juliet Yankee 1, of course, King Hussein of Jordan, Barry Goldwater, you know, famous hams. Tell us about any of them that you've either worked with or had communications with, if you would.
Well, you know, I really haven't paid much attention to that. And, you know, when I work someone on radio, to me, everybody is a ham. Mm-hmm. And I usually don't know if they're famous or not famous.
Yep. Yep. That would make sense. We're live with Mr. Martin F. Jue, the owner and founder of MFJ. If you have a question, put it in the comment section. We'll make it part of the show. Nice comment from the Quarantine Catholic. Thank you for joining the show, by the way. It's an honor to meet you. He said, this is just fascinating. Wow, what a great find on my lunch hour. We're really honored you've come to watch the show. Well, welcome anytime. Grateful you're here. Thank you for the comment. Mr. Jue, question from Rodney in Holland. His call sign is Papa Alpha 9 Romeo Whiskey. So Papa Alpha 9 Romeo Whiskey. Question, why is it that even with the advanced MOSFET technology we have today, we cannot compare with the sound and ruggedness of tubes? That's a neat comment, because there is. I mean, he says even if tubes are scarce, right? Because most tubes come from China now. But, I mean, the warmth of those old amplifiers and the ones that you make, like the 811H, right? The AL1500, those are amplifiers using tubes, whether they be the glowing tubes or the iMac tube in the 1500. There's just a warmth to those amplifiers, you know, and it's a neat comment. He's asking, why do you think it is today that with MOSFETs instead of these tubes, we just can't achieve that warm sound that you get from a tube amp?
Well, you know, sometimes, cold and perfect is not as good as something that's slightly distorted, where some of the edges are taken off. Sometimes we like that better, or hear that better, or see that better. And I think in vacuum tubes may not be as linear as some of the solid state devices, and it provides some taking off the edges that will make things sound less harsh and better.
I would agree with that. Absolutely. By the way, one of my goals here, I love my ALS 1306. That's my baby. I mean, it really is. Wonderful amplifier from Ameritron. But I'm just on the edge. I've got to be honest with you. I'm on the edge. I still would like the AL1500. How hard is it to find iMac tubes for that amplifier?
iMac tubes are very difficult to find now, and not only that, but the prices have skyrocketed to just an unaffordable, incredible cost. That's where all the cost is on some of those tube-type amplifiers. I was asking Randy Nash, the manager of Ameritron, I said, this tube must cost $4,000, and he said, they cost more than that.
Are you kidding?
Yeah.
Wow. Holy mackerel. That makes buying that type of, you know, amplifier just prohibitively expensive if just the tube is over $4,000.
Yeah, that is something.
Yep, Kevin O'Dubahan joining us from Ireland. He says, question, if it was possible for you to go back in time, is there something you would do differently or sooner than you did?
Well, I'm not sure if there's something that I would have done differently or sooner. We did as much as we could, as soon as we could. For example, in the days of through-hole components, we had to stuff those by hands, but because the machinery for automated stuffing were just incredibly expensive. But as soon as surface mount parts became available, the machinery was much less expensive, and we went directly to that. And early on, we started making cabinets first by hand, like I was talking about with those punch and die set that we used to hammer to punch the holes. We started off with pantograph type of punch presses, and then we went to NC numerical control punch presses, and then to CNC machines, which we still use.
Yep.
I'm trying to think of something
you might have done differently or wish you would have done sooner was this question.
Okay. I think maybe one of the things was we used to paint the cabinets using spray paint, and I wish we had gone to using pre-painted sheet aluminum where we could bend it. But even at that time, we had to work with the manufacturer to provide us with sheets of aluminum that were pre-painted that we could bend without cracking.
Mm-hmm. Yep, yep.
That would have been a change that I would have made.
Very good. Thank you, Mr. Jue. Appreciate that. We're live with Martin F. Jue celebrating his 50th year in business at MFJ. I want to take a moment out. This is a first-timer to our channel. This is Lima Bravo 4, Foxtrot Hotel. Bob Vinorum, all the way from Norway. Thank you so much for joining us today. It's an honor to have you here today. Ron Walensky from the Seattle area. He lives in Monroe. His call sign, November 8, Whiskey Charlie Romeo. Question, how do you come up with an idea to create a new product? Good question, Ron.
Well, a lot of these products came about as I was operating ham radios, and I needed a device, or a device would have made it easier for me to operate or put an antenna up. Sometimes these ideas come when I'm taking a shower. A lot of these ideas come from hams who wish they had a product, and but the best products that I have found are products that the hams didn't even know that they needed. For example, the antenna analyzer. I don't know, this must have been 35 years ago. Mm-hmm. I was sitting on a Sunday afternoon working on a product to measure RF resistance of an antenna without having to twist knobs and balance the bridge, where I could, a product that would read RF antenna resistance directly. And it suddenly occurred to me, why not read SWR directly? And that was the beginning of the antenna analyzer.
Wow.
It was a handheld device with a variable frequency source built in, mm-hmm, that could measure SWR. And you didn't have to take a transmitter and a wattmeter out to the antenna site. And back then, hams didn't know they needed a product like that to simplify their antenna life. And when we brought that out, it took a while for hams to understand what this could do. But once they did, it became our best-selling product. And it also has been copied throughout the world. And it's even started companies that do nothing but make antenna analyzers.
Mm-hmm. That's a good point. Absolutely. Yep. And that was a big, I would say that was your high watermark when you created that for the first time.
It was. Yep. I think before then, bringing out antenna tuners was really got us rolling.
Mm-hmm. Yep, I would agree with you there. Joshua Bateman, welcome to the show. He says, question, Mr. Jue, being one of the top ham radio supply companies in the world, what does MFJ do to give back to the ham community? That's a great question, Joshua.
Well, we provide as much support as we can when ham fest groups of hams, clubs ask us for donations. We have donated to many groups. We've recently sent a big batch of co-practice oscillator to I think they were a church group of that were teaching ham radio courses.
Cool. That's pretty cool. And you guys, you've also sent quite a bit of gear to Boy Scout groups as well, haven't you?
Well, we have. We have done a lot of that. We try to support our ham radio community as much as we can.
Yeah.
We've made donations to some of the ham radio satellite that are up. We're a big supporter for our ham radio community.
Yep, I would agree, 100%. No, and you go down the wall, that I call it the hall wall, but it's like on both sides. There's tons of plaques thanking MFJ for their generosity and, you know, being so giving to people around the world. That's why I mentioned the scouts there. Mike from Jacksonville, Florida, Kilo Golf 2. Mike, welcome. Good to have you, my friend. Kilo Golf 2, Mike. Mike, congratulations on 50 years at MFJ. I'm an avid user of many MFJ products from my RCS-04, MFJ 86 meter, MFJ 998 tuner, and my Ameritron AL811. Boy, that is a big combination of MFJ gear, Mike. Wow.
Yeah, well, thank you very much, Mike.
Yep, that's pretty cool. I'm trying to get to all these questions as fast as I can, friends, so hang in there. Ron Walensky, November 8, Whiskey Charlie Romeo from Monroe, Washington. His question, on the daily emails, who writes the wonderful intro stories?
That's Richard Stubbs. He's our customer service person, and he writes all those stories once or twice a week. He's been with us for close to 30 years.
Yes.
Over 30 years.
Richard's one of the neatest people in the world, too. He's got a great sense of humor. He's a lot of fun. He's just a neat guy. Yeah. And I want to say, so this comes from Africa. This is Wine and Again. Victor 51 Whiskey. He says, I've got a 986 MFJ that I need a meter. And he's asking, do you stock parts for those tuners? He's talking about the 986 and he needs to get a new meter for it. Do you stock those replacement parts, don't you?
Yeah, we do. We have most all parts for almost all products that we've ever made.
That's excellent. So there you go, Wine. And he says, in fact, my first ATU was the 941E. That's pretty cool. That's really cool, Wine. Wow. Thank you. The Quarantine Catholic question, his call sign. This is Kilo India 5. So Kilo India 5 Whiskey Echo Papa. Kilo India 5 Whiskey Echo Papa. What advice do you have for a new ham learning to make their own wire antennas? Great question.
I think the best advice is just to build one and see what happens. Just try it out. Get started.
I agree with that. You learn from your mistakes, but you also, get the experience of it too, which I think is really cool. Yeah. So he's working on his own wire antennas. Any extra advice you might be able to give him?
If you just get started and make mistakes, that's when you learn. And it doesn't have to be any kind of special wire, just any wire that you can find to make like a dipole antenna. And you can use clothesline as long as it's metal, or you can use house wiring. Speaker wire, just any wire. Just get started on it. And insulators. You don't need any special kind of insulators. You could just use pieces of rope if it's low power enough and if it doesn't get too wet. But you can take plastic bottles and use that as insulators. You can improvise and just have fun building it and just trial and error. Just, if it doesn't work, put something else up. You can test to see how well you're in. Antenna is working by using some of the digital modes like Whisper and just see how far and what kind of reception that you get.
That's a good practical way. Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. I think the thing I would add to that, I'm not trying to say anything wrong here. Please forgive me if it comes across that way. I think a real good thing for him as well would be an antenna analyzer, because as he builds antenna, he's going to know, okay, it's got to be a little bit longer or it's got to be a little bit shorter. And then he'll have the perfect antenna after he works with it for a little while. That antenna analyzer, I think, would be a really good investment. Yeah.
It would be. An antenna analyzer is a multi-use device. I mean, it not only measure characteristics of your antenna, but it's also a signal generator. And certain ones can become a frequency counter.
That's true. Absolutely true. We're live with Mr. Martin F. Jue. Mr. MFJ, founder of the company. He celebrates this month his 50th year in business. Matt, he's got a question. He says, I use the MFJ. Actually, no, it's not a question. It's a comment. So this is a good one. He doesn't bring his call sign, just a comment. He says, I use the MFJ 1714 and MFJ 1714S, the 1714 on my ICOM V82, and the 1714S on my Yaesu FT60. Just love these antennas. Great reception and brings in the repeaters. Great. Please keep making these. That's from Matt. Nice comment, Matt.
Oh, well, thank you, Matt.
Yeah, that's a really nice comment. And we're now in continent number 4. Tom from the Middle East joins us. Hi, Tom. He's one of only a handful of HF hams licensed in Bahrain. His call sign, Alpha 92 Golf Whiskey. Okay?
Wow.
And Tom also is licensed here in the States. His state's call sign here in the U.S. is Alpha Echo 1 Tango Papa. He joins the show. And he says, congratulations on 50 years. That's a nice comment. Mr. Jue. Yeah. Sorry, I don't want to cut you off. Go ahead.
Oh, no. Thank you, Tom. That was very nice.
What is your favorite, and I've never asked you this, what's your favorite VHF, UHF antenna that you sell?
Well, my personal favorite was the one that I had designed at the very beginning, or near the beginning of MFJ. Which was it's 2/5 wave. It's a 5/8 wave antenna that stands vertically, and it provides about 3 dB of omnidirectional gain, and it can also be used as a halfway vertical on 6 meters.
Perfect. That's perfect. By the way, whoever just moved the iPad, thank you very, very much. That's perfect. I would say Richard came in. Did Richard come in?
Oh, no. I must have bumped it.
No, it's perfect. Now it's perfect on you. It really is. Okay, so that is your VHF, UHF. What's your favorite HF antenna?
Okay, well, my very favorite one is what we call the MFJ 1796. It's a 12-foot tall vertical. It's omnidirectional. It requires no radios, and it covers 40, 20, 15, 10, 6, and 2 meters. And it uses end loading for really high efficiency and has a built-in balance so you can feed it directly with coax. So only 12 feet tall.
It's only 12 feet tall.
Yeah, and it works really well. I've used one of those for a long time as my personal antenna.
Wow, that's fantastic. Now, what's interesting about that is that you say it's got a coil on it. So is that one of those ones you're going to clip the alligator clip on part of the coil to figure out where on 40 you want to work?
No, this is automatic band switching. You put it up and you can operate all of those bands.
And that model number again?
The MFJ 1796, 1796.
Fantastic. I need to try out one of those. That sounds like a great antenna because I could use a 40-meter antenna. I really could use a good 40-meter. That's great. 12 feet tall. Holy cow. A neat comment and a question from Andy New from the United Kingdom. His call sign is Mike 7, Charlie Union, November. He says, question, what product is Mr. Jue most proud of?
Well, I have to say the MFJ 259 antenna analyzer. Makes putting antennas up and trimming antennas up very easy. And that was the product that I was talking about that sprung whole new industries for just that product alone.
Wow. Yeah, that's true. I want to say this neat comment that came. There's no call sign here, so no worries. Tonto Emeritus, good comment. And I think there's so many amateurs that would agree with this. He said, why can't we start making tubes again here in the U.S. of A? And I totally agree with that, 100%. We used to have wonderful tube manufacturers here in the States. And then as TVs and radios and amateur radios went to MOSFETs, that all changed. It really did. And it's really too bad that we don't have tube manufacturers here in the States. I think it's just, would you ever consider, Mr. Jue, opening up a tube factory? Were you going to make some tubes yourself to try and do it all in-house? Would you ever consider something like that, you think?
Well, probably not, because the demand for tubes have gotten to the point where it's not economically feasible to build tubes.
Got it. Okay. I totally understand that. And that's okay. I mean, that's why so many of them come from China now. It's just through the cost, you know, the amount of costs is involved. Kevin O'Doublehand from Ireland. I seem to remember MFJ donating equipment to the RAIBC, which is the Radio Amateurs Invalid and Blind Club. I can imagine you doing that. You guys really give back a lot to the community. And one other thing I think that's so important for people to understand, MFJ employs people and teaches them a trade. Now, I had a wonderful visit on Sunday night on Gary Pierce's Ham Radio Now show. And it was such a nice visit with Gary and visit with Matt and visit with James. And Jim in Northern California made such a great comment about MFJ. He said, there are people that will say negative things towards MFJ, but the one thing is they are in business. They help us tremendously. And every one of his MFJ pieces of equipment works just fine. But what he said that stood out to me was that MFJ can take someone like from high school, you know, maybe someone that's, you know, midlife or older in life, teach them how to solder, teach them how to build things, give them a trade level education, and then give them a career. And you've done that so well, you know, for years. And he said, you know, Mississippi is not the hotbed for, like, you know, this great technology boom, but MFJ puts their money in their people. Talk about that, would you please? Because you employ a lot of people there between the four buildings.
Well, we do, and it doesn't matter who the people are. We're willing to take them on, try them out, and if they can do the job, we like for them to stay. We get a lot of people that couldn't get jobs anywhere else, mm-hmm. and we've trained them. Most of the training is on the job. It's not very difficult to do, but it does take months of training, and some even become electronic technicians. But they learn basic job skills, such as just coming to work on time, showing up every day, and doing the work correctly. And those are the kind of skills that they can take with them wherever they go. You know, if you walk through our workplaces, you'll think we were a united nation because we have so many different people from so many different places. And to us, the only thing that matters is what they can do.
Yes, absolutely. And you have multi-generational people there, too. You got people who started out a long time ago, and now their child is working at MFJ as well, or a grandchild, you know, multiple generations. It's just like that's happened many times in your lifetime at MFJ, where people have worked many years, then their children get a job at MFJ and so forth. That's happened quite a bit, hasn't it?
Well, it has. And at various times, we had at the same time, mother, daughter, and granddaughter working here and retired. We've had several who have retired here after over 40 years. Wow. This has been their only job.
That's fantastic. There was one time, and I want, seriously, Mr. Jue, this is so important to me to tell you this. I am so grateful to have you. This was the only interview I wanted all year. I've talked about that a few times on the show, because I knew October of 2022 was your 50th year in business. And I really am grateful for this interview with you. The one thing I remember, I believe it was the first time that we spoke, and this was, gosh, a year and a half, 2 years ago. And I asked you what you're most proud of. Do you remember what you said? If you don't, I'll tell you.
It's to provide jobs.
Yes.
For our community.
Yes. It was about not laying anybody off in the history of MFJ. You've never had to lay a single person off.
That's right. We've never had to lay a single person off. I mean, even during COVID, when we couldn't get parts, we were building products that we didn't have orders for just to keep them working.
That's fantastic. And that's the MFJ. And you guys were gutted. You were hurt so bad with COVID. You know, you lost Mike, and that was a huge loss for MFJ. For people that don't know Mike, you know, Mike was the Ameritron guy. I mean, he was the head of Ameritron. That was a huge, huge loss to COVID. And, you know, some great people in amateur radio have come out of MFJ. Ray Novak, senior sales manager for ICOM North America, started at MFJ. What was Ray like when he started there at MFJ, Mr. Jue? Tell us about Ray.
Well, he was just out of junior college. He and Mike started at the same time from the same school. Ray was very energetic. He would take any task on, and he would go to all the ham fests, and he was a good technician, it was a good thing that ICOM snapped him up, and he rose very quickly in the ICOM world.
Isn't that great? And that came, Ray came from MFJ. Another person that unfortunately doesn't work there anymore. But I, you know, when I talked to Jared, you remember Jared Marsh, I know. Every time I speak with Jared, he's up in the Northeast now working for the federal government. But he mentions you and how special you are and how grateful he was for his time there. And he said, you know, someday I'd like to come back. This guy has like a master's in nuclear science. Phenomenal.
Yeah, he has a PhD in nuclear physics.
Physics, that's what it is, nuclear physics, yeah. Unbelievable, yeah. Steve in the UK, 2 Echo Zero X-Ray Sierra Hotel. Question, and I'll give you the call sign again, 2 Echo Zero X-Ray Sierra Hotel. Question, is there a product you make that surprised you how popular it became? That's a neat question, Steve.
Well, I think the SDR-TR switch surprised me with how popular it became. It was product that one of the SDR receiver manufacturer asked us to produce, which we did. And I'm trying to remember exactly what it did. I think what it did was to the SDR receiver was used as a second receiver, and you needed a way to automatically switch the antenna from the transmitter to this second receiver. And that sold like crazy.
That one surprised you, didn't it?
It did.
Yeah.
It did.
I got to ask you a fun question. And this wasn't on the 10 questions list. That was actually like 18 million questions. Anyway, all right, Superhet or SDR, what would you choose?
Well, of course, I grew up with Superhets, and those are products that I can understand and be able to work on. But SDR is much more versatile. They're much cheaper.
Yes.
But you have to be a software man to be able to do any work on them.
True. Yep, it's a computer. That's exactly it.
It's a computer.
Yep,
yeah.
Exactly it. Rodney from Holland with a great question. He got another one here. Papa Alpha 9 Romeo Whiskey. Isn't this neat? He writes down everyone's call sign. Papa Alpha 9 Romeo Whiskey. Question, how hard is it to maintain quality while still being competitive and relevant, especially being one of the top ham companies out there?
Well, you know, we are always working on quality, and it's a very difficult problem. But the main thing is to train our people to care. If they care, then we can have quality products, because we have to have a way to catch any problems if they do occur.
Mm-hmm. That's a great comment. Great comment, sirs. That's very good. Thank you. And Rodney, I hope that answers your question good. You know, one of the other parts of that question I think is really good. He talks about maintaining quality. Also, how do you stay relevant in amateur radio? And the reason I say relevant, because this is part of Rodney's question, the coronavirus hurt amateur radio. It, not only at MFJ, it hurt Elecraft, it hurt Flex, it hurt ICOM and Yaesu. Everyone was impacted by the coronavirus issue. How do you remain relevant in amateur radio during this tough time?
Well, I'm not sure what relevant.
Well, I think keeping your name out there. I know you do a ton of ads in QST magazine.
Okay. Well, we never reduced advertising. We continue to run as many pages and as many, done as much advertising as we had ever done, and increased the digital side of it. And we've always had tons of back orders. We just weren't able to produce the back orders that we needed to because of the shortage of people and raw materials because of the supply chain. So we never had a lack for orders. We just couldn't produce them.
Yeah, and that's why the K4 from Ellicraft took a while to get into people's homes that they had ordered. And a lot of people in amateur radio were struggling, waiting for components. That's true. And Mike in Jacksonville kind of piggybacks that. Kilo Golf 2 Mike. Question, has supply chain issues been a major factor for MFJ? Again, Kilo Golf 2 Mike.
It has been a very, very major factor for us. There were times where we had placed an order for parts or some products like 2 years ago, and we would order them again, and we would have double order, and all of a sudden they would all show up at the same time. But during those 2 years, we couldn't produce some products like that. Major problem.
That's tough.
Yeah. I mean, the time delay and the shipping costs were major.
Yeah. And that's hurt a lot of folks in amateur radio for sure. Anders Kyle, Lima Bravo 3, Bravo Juliet. He is from Norway. He says, hello, Martin. I want to say your radio Yaesu FT891 is good and small, good modulation, nice size. I go a lot portable because of noise. Really love that radio. I also love the Yaesu FTDX10 as well. So he's talking about his various radios there. And I guess now you have a FT891, don't you?
I think so. I can't remember. I have so many radios.
Yeah, no question.
One of my very favorite radio was a very early model of the Yaesu. I think this might have been their very first fully transistorized transceiver, and that was the FT7, which was a 10-watt single sideband CW radio. I think it was 10 watts.
That's really cool. And you got one of the first ones. That's neat. Don, November 5, Sierra Kilo Tango with a good question. He says, are there any vendors who are no longer in business that you particularly miss? That's a neat question, actually. Don, thank you for that.
Well, I miss Tentec. I use a lot of their equipment.
Mm-hmm. It's been tough to see them go through what they did. It was almost like a slow, painful death. It really was. Yeah. Tom in Bahrain, Alpha 92 Golf Whiskey. Question, what's your most prized radio in your collection?
My most prized radio. Okay. KX1.
Right away, KX1. There it is. Yep. And you know what's cool is that Jim on the Sunday show had one right behind him. At a KX1. That's so cool. Why is it your favorite?
Oh, I can have it with me at any time. I can throw a wire up anywhere, and it has a built-in key. It's a complete station that you can have with you anywhere.
That's great. That's good. By the way, Matt forgot to give his call sign. He wants to make sure you know what his call sign is. Matt's call sign is Kilo Foxtrot 4. Kilo, Sierra, Kilo. All right. Last call for questions to Mr. Martin F. Jue, celebrating his 50th year at MFJ this month. I want to welcome continent number 6. Wow. Continent number 6 is here, and I am so grateful. It's a very dear friend. This is Glenn Stevenson coming all the way from VK Land. And Glenn's call sign, by the way, Victor Kilo 2 Golf Sierra Tango. That's Victor Kilo 2 Golf Sierra Tango. He says hello to all of us here. And Glenn, hello to you as well. Thanks for coming. Jeff, with a nice thanks for that link on the 1796. That's really, really good. Thank you. Andy Cowley from the UK, 2 Echo 0 Romeo Echo Echo. So 2 Echo 0 Romeo Echo Echo. How are you staffing I'm sorry, let's throw it over. It's not that hard of a question, but Larry's not reading it very well. Sorry. How are your staffing levels now at MFJ?
They're not what we needed. It's not very good. We are still down, I don't know, 20-30% of the people that we need to catch up on back orders, or even more percentage.
And that's too bad, because you offer a career. I mean, you offer them a career someplace they can grow and grow into a great job there. It's too bad. I want to welcome Alfred Archer, Kilo 4, Victor Alpha Oscar. That's Kilo 4, Victor Alpha Oscar. He said, congratulations, Mr. Jew. That's really, really nice. Thank you for that. Appreciate it, Alfred. Don here says, Mr. Jew and his call sign, November 5, Sierra Kilo Tango. He said, Mr. Jew, I have the MFJ 1890 Moxon and MFJ 1896 Moxon. Thank you for making Moxon part of your product line. That's a nice comment, Don. Thank you. It's a nice comment, indeed.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, that's a nice antenna and a very nice man that came up with that.
Yeah, that was. Yeah, that was Don. Don's a dear friend here to the channel, and he's a really nice guy. Very smart him, too. Anders Kyle in Norway, Lima Bravo 3 Bravo Juliet. You've already got his down. Lima Bravo 3 Bravo Juliet. Question, how much efficiency will one lose with a tuner versus a pure monoband resonant antenna?
Well, that's hard to say. If you take a dipole cut for the frequency that you want, your efficiency is up in the 98-99% range. The efficiency going through a tuner depends on what you're tuning. If it's a very short antenna, your efficiency won't be very large. If it's a full size antenna, it's probably going to be better. It could range from a few percentage to high 90%, depending on what the load is.
Mm-hmm. Yep. We're live with Martin F. Jue. This is the final bunch of questions. We'll get to the ones that are currently on the screen, so I'll make sure and get to the ones that are there. But I'm putting a little mark by the last ones here, so that way I know where we're at. Okay. This is an interesting thing. Joshua Bateman, he wanted to make sure you had his call sign. Joshua's call sign is November 1, Juliet, Bravo.
Okay.
All right.
November 1, Juliet, Bravo. Got it.
Yep. And then question from Winan, which is Victor 51 Whiskey. Question, how do you do quality control at MFJ?
We have a technician at the end of the line, and then during the line, as they produce a product, parts of it in sequence, if someone sees a mistake that while putting it together, that person doesn't fix the problem, but takes it back to the person who made the mistake and let them correct it. And that's an ongoing process. And after a while, they know not to make that mistake.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's good, because you end up with better quality control then, because people are looking at it. And what's interesting, it's not computer made. These things are not computer done. These are built by hand. Fantastic.
Yeah. And I want to point out something about quality. I think when people speak of quality, I think what they're speaking of is how the product is put together. Now, the products that we build, the components that we use are all good, high-quality components. The things like the knobs or the transistors and PC board, all of those are first-rate components. And I think when they speak of quality, they mean that how do we make sure the things are done right? In other words, things like screws are tightened, our knobs are put on, things like that.
That's good. Thank you, Mr. Jue. Appreciate that. Anders Kyle from Norway, Lima Bravo 3, Bravo Juliet question. Well, let me give you it again. You've already got it there, probably. Lima Bravo 3, Bravo Juliet. There okay. you go, my friend. He says, question, which of these antennas do you think is best as a vertical HF antenna, a 5/8 wave or a 3/4 wavelength antenna?
Well,
And his name is Anders, by the way.
Anders, okay.
A 5/8 wave will give you nearly 3 dB more gain, at least theoretically. I'm not sure about the 3/4 wave. I think that will move the takeoff point up. But the one I really favor more than either one of those is a half wave antenna.
Mm-hmm. You like it over the 5/8 wave?
Well, I do. I'm not sure that a 5/8 wave will produce the theoretical gain in a practical environment.
Mm-hmm. Very good. Well, thank you. And he should know he's an engineer. So you're talking to the real deal here. So Matt, Kilo Fox 4, Kilo Sierra Kilo. That's Kilo Fox 4, Kilo Sierra Kilo. My MFJ works fantastic. My MFJ equipment, he says, works fantastic. Great products. I also have an MFJ 817 VHF, UHF, SWR meter that works great. Honored to be a part of this. Matt, we're grateful you're here and honored you are. Thank you. Also want to welcome Scott from Colorado. Also, big, big ups to P. Moore. November 5, Yankee India Zulu is here. Welcome to the show. Andy New from the UK, Mike 7, Charlie Union November. How effective are the various loop tuners that you manufacture? I think he means loop antennas. So, you know, I believe that's what he's talking about.
Well, we make both loop tuners and loop antennas.
Okay, there you go. So okay. how effective okay. are they?
Okay. The loop tuners work very well because we use a butterfly capacitor that has no rotating contacts. Now, in the loop tuners, we don't weld all the contacts as we do in the loop antenna. In the loop antenna, every contact is welded. Every plate is welded. Now, in the loop tuner, there is some contact resistance at the point where the loop attaches to the loop tuner. And but the efficiency of that can be varied. It can be increased by making the loop conductor larger in diameter and also larger in the thickness of the conductor, or you could even use a flat strip for the conductor to improve the efficiency. But the biggest efficiency would come from making the loop radiator larger in diameter, as close to it being a non-loop. And you can get efficiencies that's close to a full-size dipole if you make the loop large enough. That's the advantage of a tuner. You can take and make a small loop antenna just about anywhere.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, true. I also want to share this with you. Tom in Bahrain, Alpha 92 Golf Whiskey. He has an MFJ 1700, the adjustable whip antenna. And sorry, not ma'am, probably got the wrong, not the 1700, 1796, I forget. Anyway, it's your adjustable whip antenna. It just comes apart, you know, goes up to the 20-meter band, then you shorten it as you work 17 and 15 and 12 and 10. Tom has worked the world with this from Bulgaria. Just absolutely puts his antenna next to the Persian Gulf, and he works the world, including, by the way, North Korea. He has North Korea in his log.
Wow.
And it's at 85 watts. I mean, he's working with that antenna from Bahrain into Africa, into the United States and Canada, up towards Japan, into the North Korea, and down towards Australia. He's done amazing with that antenna. Your adjustable whip antenna and the bumper mount, you know, the bumper trailer mount with it. Mm-hmm. It just makes that thing work all over the world. Tom, Alpha 92 Golf Whiskey. I mean, he raves about that antenna, how well it works, and he never uses more than 85 watts.
That is amazing. You know, when you adjust that antenna, it becomes a full-size antenna. And if you work it against ground, especially with that large body of water, your efficiency is about as good as it can get. Come back in about 30 seconds?
Sure you can. Absolutely.
Okay.
Thank you.
Be right back.
Thank you, sir. No worries. We're live with Martin F. Jue from MFJ. We're grateful that he's joining us today all the way from Starkville, Mississippi. We're out of time for questions. I got an hour with him, and we are currently pushing up at 1 hour and 11 minutes. Okay? While Mr. Jue is away, I want to share this with you. This weekend, CQ Worldwide SSB is going on. And just to give you a little forecast, just to prepare you a little bit, your forecast for CQ Worldwide is very good. SFI will rise again today. I believe by the weekend for CQ Worldwide will be within the 125 to 140 range. That's what I forecast last week. And now it's coming. The stun spots are coming. The noise floor is going to be the issue. Okay, today S1, S3 at times, S3, S4 tomorrow, and possibly as high as S4 to S6 on Saturday for CQ Worldwide. Oh, that's kind of a bummer. But good conditions, guys, all the way into southern Sweden and Norway, all the way into the northern territories and of Canada and into Alaska, 20 meters, 17, 15, 12, and 10. For CQ Worldwide weekend, this is going to be such an amazing weekend for you to use your radio. And this is such a special weekend. The SFIs are there. And more importantly, let me show you this real quick while Mr. Jue is taking care of something real quick. The maximum usable frequency map from today. Look at how far north 10 meters goes. And all the yellow area is 10 meters. All the yellow circles with numbers show the 10-meter band. You're going to work this literally worldwide from northern Canada all the way to the tip of South America, from northern Europe all the way to Cape Town, South Africa, and from Asia down into Australia, New Zealand. This is phenomenal conditions this weekend for CQ Worldwide. Close look at the northern Pacific. You see the 10-meter band throughout and pushing up north towards Alaska. These were conditions about 2 hours ago, and as we move forward, you kind of see everything kind of continue to go into the southern hemisphere. Again, 10 meters everywhere, and you'll make some great calls. So please enjoy CQ Worldwide. You'll have the best conditions, just the noise floors will be higher on like the 10 megahertz and down band. So, you know, if you're going to work 40, 60, 80, 160, going to be pretty loud, especially during the daytime. Let's get back to Mr. Martin F. Jue for the final questions here, celebrating his 50th year at MFJ. Mr. Jue, we want to welcome you back. Thank you for coming back on to our little stream here, because we're grateful you are. And my goodness, I think I have a problem here. I've got a photo of you up on the screen, but I don't have the real you. So we're going to put the real you right there. All right. Thank you for being patient with us. We appreciate it. Wine in Africa, Victor 5-1, whiskey. Isn't it some everybody's call sign? He writes it down. Victor 51, whiskey. Question, how do you do quality control? It can't be easy to get all of your stuff out without faults, because we're all human. And he already addressed that question, where they have multiple places in the production line that check the equipment. And if it's bad, they'll take it back to that part of the line that you know, is creating that. Because basically what MFJ does, just to kind of give you the inside tour, from a visual perspective, without showing you, okay? They build a certain amount of products per day, okay? And those products are what everybody's working on in the back room. as they go through the build process, they have a quality control person that's kind of in the middle of the process of the build, and they have another person at the end of the build, okay? And that person that's in the middle of the build, if there's a problem with the product, they'll go back to the part of the line that's putting that part on the system, on the component. Same thing at the end. They'll check at the end. If there's problems there, they will ship it back to the people who worked on that area of the board. They do employ so many people because they aren't robotically making parts. They make them the old-fashioned way by hand. And it's amazing. You even silk screen your gear too, or don't you? You use a silk screen to put your model numbers and stuff on it, don't you, Mr. Jue?
We do. And let me also add to your explanation about how we package antennas at High Gain and Cushcraft. You know, of course, an antenna, you can't ship it assembled, so it's basically a box of parts. Mm-hmm. And what we do to make sure that we get the right stuff in there is the bigger parts, we have what we call a shuttle board. What that is, it's basically a board with the outline of each one of the bigger parts. So you would put all the parts on that board so it matches the outline, and you can visually see that all those parts were there before it gets packed into a box. And then the component bags, that is all the screws and the nuts and the bolts and the clamps, are put into plastic bags. And there can be multiple bags, and each one of those bags are weighed. And then this is all put together into a box to form the complete antenna. And then that box is weighed, and it's recorded, and on the label, the weight, that date, and that particular box is recorded, so we can identify when a problem has occurred from weighing and visually inspecting it.
Interesting. That's an interesting way to do it. By weight, my goodness. We'll give Joshua the final question, but I'll throw a couple more in because I know people came late here today. Joshua's call sign, November 1, Juliet Bravo. So November 1, Juliet Bravo. He says, my first MFJ 2010 has seen better days, and I'm looking to replace it. What MFJ dipole would you recommend for all the HF bands?
Well, let's see. If I remember right, the 2010 is a off-center fair dipole. Is that what you have?
Yeah, it's a 2010. And he's wondering okay. What you'd recommend for all the HF bands. I don't know if he's going to go to 160 with that or not. It's a lot of room for a dipole.
Okay. Well, now, the 2010 is an antenna that will have a low SWR on the band that it's designed to operate on. Now, if you're okay with using an antenna tuner, either manually or automatically to operate all bands, a simple doublet antenna, which consists of around 102 feet of wire, center fed with open wire line, like 450 ohm ladder line, would make an excellent all band antenna that could be very efficient.
Yeah, and this is your off center fed dipole antenna, and it'll handle 300 watts. Pretty good. That's a nice piece of kit right there. Yeah, thank you for that. Also, I do want to welcome Cliff Bolts, longtime viewer of the channel. His call sign, Whiskey Delta 4, Oscar Bravo Papa. He says, I have many MFJ products that I have purchased over the last 40 years and enjoy all of them, particularly my Hex Beam and the 259D. Congratulations on your 50th year. Nice work, Cliff.
Yeah, thank you, Cliff.
That's a nice comment. Alpha, we got another thing here from William in Akron, Ohio. Alpha Delta 8, India Tango. He's in Akron, Ohio here in the States. He says, Mr. Jue, congratulations on your 50th year anniversary. Jeff in Tennessee, November 4 Pop Oscar Delta, says it really well. I would personally like to thank Mr. Jue and his entire team, past and present, for all of their contributions to the hobby. Nice comment, Jeff. Yep.
Thank you.
Yeah. Also, want a big welcome to Temporarily Offline Ham Radio. That is T.O., and T.O. comes from not only Coffee and Ham Radios, but a great YouTube channel here. Just a really special guy. And T.O., I'm really grateful you're here. Thank you for coming today. It's great to have you. I mean, just a neat, neat guy. Very good guy. Gary, Kilo, Quebec 4. Charlie Papazulo. So Kilo, Quebec 4, Charlie Papazulo. I was late, but listening to the interview now. Gary, we're grateful you came. Thank you. DD, this is call sign Kilo India 5, Charlie Delta Quebec. Congratulations, Martin and company, for your 50th. I love your 993B tuner and all other MFJ products. God bless you. Nice comment, DD. That's beautiful.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. That's good stuff. Yeah. And Rodney noticed the polo. I told Mr. Jube when we started, I said, okay, I'm going to wear my MFJ shirt. He said, oh, that's really nice of you. Bless your heart. He's a very special guy. He really is. And good conditions going in. And this is a good forecast. This is a good forecast for you this weekend, guys. This is going to be the best CQ Worldwide SSB we've had in many, many years. Truly, I mean that. MUF in Great Britain peaked today at 13.9 megahertz. Expect great conditions this weekend. Andy New, thank you for joining the show. Thank you for being a part of it, everybody. Mr. Jue, do you have any final questions or comments you'd like to share with folks here?
Well, I would like to thank ham radio operators all over the world for these 50 wonderful years with our community. Thank you very much. If it wasn't for y'all, we wouldn't be here.
That's the way it is. Yeah. And you know, as he says, I think really good, his best accomplishment was never having to lay an employee off. You're a special guy. You know,
well, thank you.
My final question is probably the one that a lot of people wonder about. How much farther do you think you're going to go with this? This is 50 years. So what are your goals still?
Well, I'm in no hurry, but I would like to find someone who has the same values that MFJ stands for to pass the baton and to continue the tradition of providing good products for the next generation of hams and to take care of our employees.
Wow. Isn't that nice? That not only is he talking about the products, but he brings up the employees as well. Those people are like family to you, aren't they?
Well, they are. They are. They're my extended family.
That's the kind of guy he is. DD, you ask a question about any Black Friday or holiday sales at MFJ. We're going to have Richard Stubbs here coming up in November, right before Black Friday, with some MFJ Black Friday deals. There's your announcement. Yeah. Yeah. So I believe it's the 23rd of November. It's the Wednesday before Halloween. No, it's 23rd. It's the week of Thanksgiving, the day before. And Richard going to have some great sales from MFJ that y'all could take part in here from the show. So thanks for bringing that up. Mr. Jue, thank you for being a part of this. This has truly been my honor. I got the one show I hoped I could get, and that was with you. God bless you, my friend. I wish you well. Don't stop doing what you're doing, and just stay healthy, will you, please? We love you.
Oh, well, thank you very much, Larry. I have enjoy being on your show and visiting with so many hams across the world. Thank you very much.
That's very kind. We're going to show remember the old days when TV stations used to sign off the air?
Mm-hmm.
Yep. We're going to show one of those old sign-offs right now from Jackson, Mississippi, in honor of you today. It'll be from WLBT-TV. So hang in there. I'll be right back with you, okay?
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you for coming, Mr. Jue. Best of wishes to you. That is my dear friend, Martin F. Jue, and I'm just so grateful to say it. And you know what? I typically would never do a show looking like this, but it was too important not to. So thank you guys all for coming. I appreciate it. Thank you guys sincerely. I mean that. I do. All right. We're going to sign off the show now with a great sign off from the old days in television. This is from WLBT out of Jackson, Mississippi. It's one of the most beautiful United States sign offs, or outside the states, they call them close downs of television in history. I think it's beautiful. It's quintessential South United States. My name's Larry. My call sign, Navature Radio, is Kilo 7 Hotel November. May God richly bless you this day, give you a good night's rest. So tomorrow when you wake up, you remember to be thankful for the gift of another day. Until next time, goodbye, everybody.
A service of TV3 Incorporated concludes another broadcast day. WLBT operates on full power as designated for Channel 3, Video Microwave KKS-37, and Audio Microwave KLQ-46. WLBT Jackson, Mississippi maintains studios at 715 South Jefferson Street with transmitter located southeast of Raymond, Mississippi. WLBT provides viewers in Mississippi and portions of Louisiana and Arkansas with the finest in television programming. Speaking for the staff and management, this is Bert Case wishing you and yours a pleasant good night and a good morning.